All right.
Okay, good morning, everyone. We're a few minutes late, but no problem. Welcome to my talk, The Road to Continuous Deployment. I know I tend to talk quite fast. I try to pace myself a bit because probably not everyone is like an English native speaker in here, I guess. If you have any problems with understanding me or my weird German accent, just like throw stuff at me and I'll then try to speak slower and more clear. In the next like 50 minutes, I want to talk about what continuous deployment actually is, why you should do it, what benefit it has, and how you can introduce it in your company. And what steps you can take like starting next week to implement parts of continuous deployment and what benefits you get out of that. Before I start with that, a few words about me. I work at a company called ResearchGate. It's a social network for scientists based in Berlin. It's all about scientists collaborating with each other, sharing publications, talking about scientific questions. We have some investors, table tennis, kicker, elephants, visitors, and if you have any questions about that, you can ask me. And also, if you have questions about the talk in between, just raise your hand and we can do this directly or at the end. And the slides will be online as speaker deck later on, or I will upload them sometime today. So you can also revisit them, and there are lots of notes on it about what I was talking on, so you actually can see this next week as well. That was about me. I have a few questions about you. Just raise your hand if it applies to you. Who is working for like a company? Okay. Who is doing freelancing? Who is self-employed? Two. Who is working mostly on a single product or like one big product the company is doing? Okay. Who's working more as in an agency, doing like multiple short-term products? Okay. Now a few questions, just like raise your hand if you know what it is. Do you know continuous integration? What it means? Okay. Who's doing continuous integration? That's less. Why that? Who's doing continuous deployment? Okay, like a few. Awesome. Yes. Who's doing feature flags or feature toggles? Two, three, four, five. Who's doing central log management? Like a few more. Who's measuring key performance indicators? Even less, I think. Who knows what to-the-glass monitoring is? Okay. If you don't know, don't fear, you will know after the talk, hopefully. So, continuous deployment is our main topic, and in basic, continuous deployment means that you should deploy your code changes. Safety first, yeah. Good one. So it means that you should deploy your code changes to production as often as possible. If you look at the software development approaches, the classic software development approach, which probably has been around for like 30, 40 years, is something like the waterfall model. That means you have some requirements that business owners put down in big requirement documents that are usually like books long. Then some software architects think about a nice architecture to fulfill these requirements. Then some developers start implementing the design. At the end, there are some testers verifying and testing all if everything works. And then you release it, and then you have to fix all the bugs that happens. And if at any point in time when you see, for example, in development, that the design is not really fit to fulfill the requirements, you just go back, the architects go back again, design again, and then you start implementing the new design. This is a perfectly fine approach, especially if you ship software on DVDs every 2 years, or your software has to run in a rocket ship going to Mars, and you can't just like upload a new version very quickly. But we are doing web applications. Who's not doing web applications? We are at a PHP conference. Okay, what are you doing? Like, I would be interested. Okay, good. So we're all doing web development. That means, at least theoretically, we can release code all the time to our customers. We just have to upload this onto the server, and then the new software is live. How awesome is that? So this more slow waterfall process does not really apply to web development so much. So people came up with something called agile development, and there's lots of like mythologies in there, like Scrum, extreme programming, Kanban, and so on. basically they are working all the same. Or the main idea is to have very short iterations where you just develop small sets of features in completeness. So you have a backlog of features you want to develop, then you have like an iteration where you develop, test it and deploy it and everything until it's really ready. That could be 30 days or 2 weeks or 1 week, maybe even like a day in some companies. And then after this sprint, it's called this iteration where you develop, you release it, and then everything is fine. We have working software and all the features that need to develop for the software are added up incrementally. So now we are at releasing like every 2 weeks, maybe after each iteration. Like short question, who is doing like Scrum, Kanban, extreme programming or something like that? Okay. So I'm just not telling you something new. If you go a bit further, you could say, okay, what about not releasing after each iteration, but continuously releasing our stuff? Because, hey, we are on the web. It's probably just an rsync and a bit more. And that's called continuous deployment. Doing that has a lot of benefits. You are deploying to your production server smaller change sets of code all the time. That means instead of after 2 weeks deploying 50,000 lines of changed code, you're just deploying 100 lines of changed code. That in turn means that you produce less bugs, because shipping less code also means shipping less bugs. It's like basic mathematic. Also, what is more important is that if there are bugs in there and no software is bug free, it's much easier to find the bug that where it happened. If the change set is just like 100 lines of codes, finding the bug in this 100 line of codes that was introduced because of your release 5 minutes ago is very easy, because reading through 100 lines is not much work. Also, the developers who did this code probably already still know why they did it and how they did it. And it's not like it was 2 weeks ago or 4 weeks ago, and how do I know what I wrote 4 weeks ago? Like, I'm already in my mind much, much further for the next features. I'm already thinking about other stuff. Releasing very often also means that the time you need to bug fix something gets shorter. First, it's shorter to find. It's shorter to identify actually who to produce the bug and to fix it. And then, because you're deploying continuously and all the time anyway, your bug fix gets live to your users also very, very quickly. Also, same with quality. Like, it's not all about quality in web applications, it's also performance. If you deploy something and your performance goes down and your sites get slower, it's very easy to identify and say, okay, this is a culprit, let's roll back, let's do something differently and fix it. Same with conversion rates. Like, for example, how many people complete your sign up or order an item in your shop. If this goes down because you probably broke something or something is not working as intended anymore, you directly see this in the metrics and can fix it. It's in the end all about faster iterations, making it much faster to iterate over software, improve your software, fix your software, and making the time to do this as short as possible. So maybe you're thinking now, hey, this continuous deployment thing, awesome, I'm sold, how can I introduce it? Important part for that is that your whole team has to live it, because it needs a certain mindset of developers caring about quality and how they work and how they develop. I'm going into this now in the next few minutes. And it's also not only doing about more releases, pushing your code more often to a production server. Because if you're just saying, okay, I'm taking my process as it is now, I'm changing nothing, I'm just doing more releases more frequently, it probably will break all the time. So you have to introduce a certain quality mindset in your company, which also has benefits without continuous deployment, which is also very nice. So let's go there step by step. Who is using version control? I think that's everyone, so I can just skip this. Awesome. Then quality of your application is very important, because you're deploying all the time, so you have to care about quality. There are different strategies how to go about that. First is manual quality assurance, that you click manually through your site, test your features and see if everything is working. Perfectly fine. You're very sure that it's working afterwards. The problem is, if you do this after every release or before every release with all the features in your site or application, it's not a very uncomplex one, so you have more than two buttons and maybe a link somewhere, this really does not scale. Even Google is much more complex than a search box, so they have lots of product and they're not relying on manual testing. That does not mean that manual testing is not could not be a good part of your strategy. Maybe there are some very important things on your application that really, really should work. Shopping cart on a shop, for example. You can say, okay, I have some part-timers or I'm offshoring this and I'm letting this test that it, this really important thing works. But for everything, this is really not doable. So we have to automate that. With automated tests, there is, of course, unit tests where you can test small unit of your work. And these are usually very fast. You just test your business logic. And this then also leads to you knowing, okay, my business logic actually works as intended. Who is doing unit testing? Okay, this is like half. Okay, the nice thing about unit tests is because you're making your code testable, that it automatically also leads to a more maintainable design, because tests are kind of documentation. If code is not testable, it's probably bad design, and so on. But this is not a test, a talk about testing. Like, unit testing should be part of your strategy for stuff that is really important and stuff that is your business logic. Then there are integration tests that could be part of your testing mix. Integration tests means you take more parts or greater parts of your code and test them in integration with each other. So for example, you have tests that not only test your business logic, but also tests that it interacts correctly with your databases. Then there are acceptance tests. This is basically automating what manual testing is doing. Instead of manually clicking through a website, you can automate this with tests like Behead or Selenium, who does it for you and automate all this clicking. This is upsides and downsides. For example, usually with every interface change, some of these tests tend to break, so you can also get some false positives. But for important stuff, this is really worth it. Of course, there are also smoke tests you can do, which is basically just doing requests at your live application platform to important sites, seeing if you don't get an error back. If you have a shop and you do a request against a product page and you get a 503 back, it's probably broken. And you can also identify this very quickly with that. Then, of course, you can do lots more with testing. There's visual regression testing, JavaScript tests that you can write. You can write regression tests for every bug that is introduced, a bug that reproduces, a test that reproduces this bug, and then fixes and write a test for it. And if you all this hook up then into a continuous integration system that runs this test automatically all the time with every commit, you have a very good testing strategy that enables you to check with every commit, is my software still working and is it able to be deployed? Who is using continuous integration servers? Okay. For those of you who don't like, a good tool that is open source is Jenkins. There's also Travis and Bamboo from Atlassian and lots of others. Just pick the one you like and which works for you. And basically, they work the same. You have a set of projects that are basically your tests of your project and they're going to be run all the time. So quality assurance. If we have all this set up, and this is also makes all what I talked about makes total sense to do, even if we won't do continuous deployment and you say, okay, I'm fine with doing deployments every 2 weeks or 4 weeks. Caring about quality is always a good thing, and automating all this is also always a very good thing. Next thing is then your development process. If you're doing continuous deployment, which means pushing out code changes all the time, feature branching does not really work anymore, which means feature branching means for every new feature developed, you have a master or trunk branch, which is your main repository, and for every new feature you branch off there, commit in there all the time for all the features, and then at the end, when the feature is finished, merge it back. If you have lots of teams and lots of developers, that could in the end up a bit like this. And at the end of your 2 weeks iteration, when everyone is finished with their features, you have lots of merge conflicts. And also, when you're doing feature branches, which means you have your feature branch, you're developing in it, committing it, at the end merge it back to master branch, you are again deploying a very big chunk and change of code. How can you deploy continuously if it's like all the development is cut off in special branches? Instead of that, people came up with doing trunk or master-based development. It depends on the version control system, if it's trunk or master. That means every commit gets integrated automatically. You just commit into your trunk or master branch. That's it. That means also potentially every commit gets deployed automatically, so we have a continuous deployment thing. That also means, regarding quality, that I should not commit something that is not stable or is not able to be deployed. So this needs like a certain mindset of people saying, okay, I'm not just committing some random stuff with var dump and die in there, because that would probably break the platform. Been there, done that. You could say that going this approach, having one master branch and nothing else, and just committing everything in there is maybe a bit too harsh, because there could be some changes that could be broken. So I want to have like a bit of more control. There's like an intermediate thing where you say, okay, you have your master branch where you commit everything in, and then I have one release branch for every day or every week where I release from, and I can cherry pick commits in there. It would look like a bit like this. So I have here my master branch, developers commit here all the time in there, and then, for example, every Sunday I create a release branch that I'm using for releasing to production, and if I have bug fixes or features or commits I want to have online before like next Sunday, I'm just merging that over in my release branch, and then like every time I want, I'm releasing continuously. Here they are doing it every day. This is actually something Facebook is using, like they are using about this approach. So trunk-based development is not something that is very esoteric. Big companies with big development teams are using that, like Google, Facebook, Etsy, and it works very well for them, even with thousands of developers. And it works also for small companies as well. Now you say, okay, this is awesome. Every commit gets in there, every commit gets tested, every commit gets into my continuous integration system, every commit gets deployed, but what about stuff that actually takes longer to develop? It's not like every feature I'm writing is just like one or two commits I can do in half a day. I also don't want to have developers having not committing their code for like 1 week because they're fearing their feature is not ready or broken, then it's also defeating the purpose of continuous integration and continuous deployment. And also there may be legal or marketing reasons why you don't want to release or push code to the customers yet. For example, there is a marketing campaign that should start at one day. It's linked with TV commercials and users should not see it before that. How do you solve that if you commit everything to trunk and everything gets deployed instant? The answer for that is something like feature flags or feature toggles, which is basically a sophisticated if statement. And the nice thing about this, it actually decouples the release of your code from the deployment of your code. That means, because when I'm using feature flags, I'm just having an if statement, a sophisticated if statement around my code that I don't want to have deployed, I don't want users to see yet. I'm able to push this online, the code doesn't get executed for users, tests run against it and everything, that everything works. And once I'm ready for users to see this, I just switch over a config setting and then the code goes live. In code it could look a bit like this. You have like a method where you maybe offshore it, like this has access method, and that just tests if a certain feature flag is active. If yes, it returns true, you execute your code. If not, it returns false. Then of course you can build fancy interfaces around that, listing you all the feature flags currently available, and also fancy interfaces instead of like having config settings in this code, being having interfaces where just product managers can check off which users are able to see it in which countries for which percentages. So actually product managers then can release the code after you deployed it, which is also for them an awesome feeling when they can say, okay, I want to put it online now. That also means, you see this already on here a bit, that this automatically enables you to do partial rollouts, which means you can roll out new features for like internal members of your company first, then maybe for a group of beta testers somewhere that you selected, then maybe for users in certain countries that are driving enough traffic up, but business-wise are probably not as important. I think, for example, Facebook is testing everything in New Zealand first, for some reason. This is a kind of like 2-year-old information, they may have changed that. And also you can say, okay, I'm just releasing my code and my stuff for only 50% of the users. And this is basically then also the groundwork for doing A/B testing. Who's doing A/B testing in that company? That's not enough. A/B testing is an awesome tool to make your application behaving much better for your users and to drive up conversion tremendously, especially if you're starting with it. And if you're using feature toggles already, it's like very easy. You just say, okay, instead of doing one version of my code, or I'm just doing developing two versions, for example, a red button and a green buy button. And then I'm having a feature toggle around both versions. And for 50% of the users, I'm setting this the green version on. And for 50% of my users, I'm setting the red version on. Then I'm measuring how this affects conversion. And I'm fine. I'm doing A/B testing already. This whole feature toggle thing is one thing to go about continuous employment. If you have other methods that work, great, awesome. The only thing is, your only goal should be to integrate all the commits and everything you develop as early as possible. So I talked about a lot about quality assurance, how important tests are for continuous deployment. I talked a lot about development process. Now let's get our code live to our server somewhere. If we think about how to get our code on servers, there are usually two steps involved. First, a build process, which means running Composer, maybe for JavaScript running Bower or NPM or Browserify to actually get NPM modules into JavaScript models that I can use in the browser, minifying JavaScript, maybe compiling CoffeeScript if we use it, minifying CSS, creating sprite maps, minifying HTML templates, building up static caches to optimize your code, compile stuff into optimized code somewhere, like for example, Symfony has this cache compilation step in there, and so on and so on. And usually you do this before every deployment in order to make your code ready to be deployed to your servers. To automate that, so the goal should be to have this build process like just one command on your command line, there are lots of tools to automate that, like ant, fing, grunt, gulp, or even custom scripts in PHP, Ruby, Python, Bash, everything that works is fine there. Who is using like custom or like build scripts for in some area to build their application? Okay. It does not matter what you're using, as long as it works, as long as it's fast and as fast as possible. So you also should measure how long it takes and tune it. Because if you want to deploy like several times a day, but your build process takes 1 hour, you are limiting yourself already to doing probably 8 releases a day. And it should be automated, like only one command and it builds your whole project in a state where the source code can just be pushed to your servers. Also, what could be sensible, if you're doing continuous integration already, hook it into your continuous integration server, the build process. For example, with Jenkins, you can just say, okay, I have one project where I build my source code in a way that it can be deployed. It generates a so-called artifact, which is the code that's deployed. Could be just a folder that is ready to be rsynced or a zip file that could be uploaded or something. And then your continuous integration server is doing this automatically for you. Now that we have built our project, we also have to deploy it, of course. Also, this deployment step, which means getting it on the servers, should be as automatic as possible. Keyword is here what you read very often, one-click deployment, which means with one click somewhere in some interface or one command entered on the command line somewhere, I should be able to build my project, if it's not built yet, and deploy it and get it on production. And not going to 15 different servers, rsyncing stuff over to 15 different servers and so on, because this leads to errors, and especially if you do it 15, 20, 30 times a day, this will also not scale. So you have to automate that. And it should be fast as well. Like, again, if you take 1 hour, 2 hours to deploy something on your production servers, it's probably will not, you can only like do 4 or 8 deployments a day. And you should also be able to roll back to the previous version very fast. Because software is not bug-free, it could be that there is some regression in there that the test did not cover. If that happens, you want to be able to roll back the previous working version very instantly. Just to give you some measures, at ResearchGate, our deployment and build process combined takes 2.5 minutes and rollback 30 seconds. So it's still not fast enough, I want to have it like lower, but at some point IO is limiting you. Also for deployment, there are lots of tools that can help you. Ansible, Capistrano, SDDeployNator, you can look at them afterwards if you are looking for one tool, or even custom scripts if you have your PHP or Bash script that is you're using for deployment and it works for you and it's maintainable, it's fine. If you're doing lots of deployment every day, there are certain things during deployment that you should think of in terms of performance. The first is cache warm-up. Like, for example, in PHP has an opcache that caches the compiled opcodes in PHP to make execution faster and not having PHP not be having to compile PHP for every request all the time. If you deploy now, your op cache is empty. That means the first users hitting your servers get actually a very slow site until everything is cached. What you can do to prevent that is just in your deployment script hook in a bit of code that actually calls a few of the URLs before users are doing. So your deployment script goes in there, does a few requests to your application server that just got the new code to warm the caches up. You usually also have other caches in your application. For example, if you're using doctrine and doctrine annotations, the parsing of the annotation is cached in the APCU cache, and so on. The second thing is, if you're deploying very often, asset invalidation. With assets, I mean CSS, JavaScript, HTML templates, images, and so on. If you deploy new code, you also usually deploy new style sheets, new JavaScript. So in order to browsers of your users not having cached these old versions, you have to invalidate these caches. One common way to do this is with cache busting flags, which means you have your URL to your CSS file, and in there, there's a small part either in the parse or in the query parameter that is just like an increment for your release version. And when you release, you increase this counter or flag, and then automatically the URL changed, and the browsers of the users don't have a cached version of this URL anymore and fetch the new version. Does that make sense? Okay, I see lots of people nodding. If you do this for every release and you're doing 15 releases every day, you're invalidating all your assets 15 times a day. So that means the cache ratio of your users are actually very bad for JavaScript. And also, if you're doing very many releases, then probably not all your CSS and JavaScript files and images change all the time. Actually, most of them won't change all the time because you're just releasing a tiny bit. So instead of having a global cache busting flag, what you can do is you make a hash over the specific file and then use this as a cache busting flag for this specific file. It's a bit more complicated because you have to basically rewrite a whole lot of URLs somewhere, but there are already tools out there that help you do this. It's like just me Googling for like 5 minutes and finding like 3 different tools for 3 different build platforms that actually help you having individual cache busting flags per file. You also, what you can do, of course, you can use e-tags, but this has other, which are also working fine and working the same way. Depends a bit on your setup and how do you want to invalidate your caching. Also, if you're deploying continuously, it's usually a good thing to have not only your production environment where you deploy to, but also like several staging systems. A setup could look like this. You have a central development server somewhere in your office where your other employees maybe can test something directly, and all your code is like directly when it's committed, it's deployed there. You have some integration environment with a separate database, which basically looks like your production environment, but with a separate database. And you have your production servers, and maybe also some near production servers, which are using the same database as production servers. That's actually the staging setup from ResearchGate. If you have such a system, you can build up a build, test, and release pipeline with that, which you also can automate in your continuous integration system like Jenkins, which means every time you commit something, it automatically gets pushed to your central development environment and people can test it and you see if something breaks also very early. Then also after every commit, you run all the tests and checks on your continuous integration servers, all your unit tests, all your integration tests, all your code sniffer stuff, static analysis you're doing. When they all work, you deploy it to your integration environment. There you can maybe, because you have a database that is kind of stable, that is not polluted by developers doing all kinds of stuff, you can run your HTTP integration test, acceptance test, Selenium test, and everything against it. If they work, you deploy to your near production system, so you have actually working tested code on there, and then maybe you have a manual trigger to deploy it to actual production to your users. Of course, the purpose of continuous, if you do it like this in such a pipeline, This can take a few minutes, and if this takes like 4 hours to run all the tests and goes through the pipeline, also the purpose is defeated somehow from continuous integration. So depending how long your tests take to run, you may have to change this a bit. And also, you still should be able to deploy stuff to production without doing all that, because there is maybe an emergency, your platform is not working, you want to fix it as soon as possible. So we have our code live now. Everything is working, we have everything set up, and then somebody wants to change the database. If you're doing like lots of deployments every day and then having to schedule schema migrations into it, can be kind of hard. So with schema migrations, I mean changing the database schema, adding new columns, adding type, changing the types of columns, and so on. The answer to this problem, how to schedule schema migrations in a way into continuous deployment in a way that it actually works and that you don't break stuff all the time, is just don't do them. See? Or if you want to do them in a non-backwards compatible breaking way. That means only do safe operations like adding columns, adding tables. This is usually very safe. You can just do them way before deployment, because the column is then there, no code is using it, but nobody complains. Or like if you can also drop columns way after deployment. So if the column is not used anymore and probably hasn't been used for 2 weeks, you can just drop it. If you really have to migrate something and have to change data types or have to copy data from one field to another field, what you can do is do it in steps. So first, for example, you add a new column, which is fine, not BC breaking. Then you write and deploy the code to our goal is now to just, instead of have a column with probably varchar of line 50, get the data in the column with varchar of line 100, which usually is also a safe operation, but okay, for the example, let's say like this. So you add the new column, then you change your code to write actually to both columns in parallel that you now have. Then you write a small script and run it to migrate all the old data from the old column to the new column. Then you change the code to read from the new column, because all data is in there. It's still written to both columns in parallel, so both are in sync now. And then you remove the duplicate writing, and then you can drop actually the old column. These are all safe operations, and if you do it in this thing, nobody will complain. You can do schema migrations easily. I already said it like one or two times, no software is bug-free. That means it's important for you, if you're doing continuous deployment, to find bugs as early as possible. That means you should actually, finding a bug is easy when everything is broken and your whole page is not working anymore, but if just one tiny part is not working, it's actually not that easy to see, because you're probably, your users won't tell you, they're just going to go away. That means detecting errors is important. You can, with detecting errors, like the first thing you should look into is your error logs. Of course, if you have 50 servers and then you SSH or DSH into all those 50 servers and tail off the error logs, it is not an ideal thing. Instead of that, you should do something, and like a few of you are already doing this, called central log management, where you push all your error logs to a central server somewhere, probably maybe an Elasticsearch or something else, where you can aggregate all the logs, search through them, do filtering and reports on that, and so on. I have a talk this afternoon as well called Monitoring and Logging Everything, which talks about this in a lot of detail. But there are not only like really errors that are in your code because exceptions are thrown, there are also other regressions that can happen. That could be logical bugs, like there is no error, there is no exception, the code works as it's written, there are no side effects, but somewhere like something was not implemented as it was meant to be. There could be performance issues, like something just gets slower. You usually also don't see this in error logs. It could be that your conversion rates, your key performance indicators get down or something. So this is also something you should notice that can happen with continuous integration. For that, you just have to plot everything and graph everything that you have. Graph all your key performance indicators, how many people are signing up every day or every second, how many people are ordering something, how many requests you have, how many calls your database you have, how fast your pages are in milliseconds. and so on. And do this in a way that you have near real-time monitoring, because it does not help you if, like, one day later you see, oh, yesterday we deployed something and our sign-up was not working anymore, we have zero sign-ups. It's kind of bad, so you should do this, notice this probably, like, hopefully 5-10 minutes after deploying it and then fix it. Tools for that are, for example, Graphite, which is an open source tool, and you get lots of nice metrics out of that if you use it. Also, more to this afternoon, which is a very nice thing that I have this talk which directly connects to that. Now, you have all your graphs and all your logs. Still, finding the cause can be kind of tricky, especially if you have, like, I don't know, 10,000 graphs plotting different things. You can do something like anomaly detection on that, for example, which basically means it analyzes all your graphs, and if there are some anomalies in there, like, for example, this spike, it alerts you. This is a screenshot from Skyline, a tool Etsy developed from Graphite, but there are also other things that work. Also, to find actually the now you know that something is broken, to really find the cause, what's broken, and if it's not clear from the code that was committed, why something is slower, or why there is this bug in there, profiling tools usually help a lot. There's XHProf, who's using XHProf. It's easy to set up, you can run it in your production environment for a small set of requests. If it's not running, and just installed, it has no performance hit on your requests. And then you can maybe run it for 1% of your requests or 0.1% or something. And this, of course, these 0.1% have a small performance hit then, they are a bit slower. But what you get out of that is a very detailed view on how your application is behaving. So you see from this request, all functions that were called, how long they took, how many memory that they consumed, and you get a very detailed view, and then can especially with performance problems, pinpoint something, also see how actually did the code go in there, why, what was the stack trace to this error, and so on. It also aggregates automatically a lot of these requests, so you can see slowest requests on there, you have reports on that, and so on. This is an open source tool, you can just install it and use it, which is awesome. There are also a few yes, there's a question? The name is XHProf. And these are just some screenshots of that. There are also solutions that are paid, where you have to pay for, that gives you additional benefits, as for example, a new thing called the Quapoo Profiler, especially for PHP applications, that is based on XHProf, but has a very nice front end, gives you lots of reports, and also gives you information that is very PHP specific, for example, how many Doctrine database queries I did, how many PDO database queries I did, how long did they take, and has a much more granular look on it as well. Then there is New Relic, which costs a lot of money, I think $100 per server per month or something. But it also has lots of features in there that can help you finding out what's happening, and it could be really worth it. Also, if you're using stuff like Symfony 2 or Zen Framework 2, they have development and profiling tools built in already. For example, Symfony 2 has this debug profiler toolbar, which gives you information about how long did the request take here, how much memory does it consume, which controller was accessed. You can click on it, dive into it, see like a nice waterfall diagram. This is all already built into Symfony 2. And it can be easily extended. You can say, okay, I have special things I want to track in my application as well if you're using Symfony 2. Or you can even use the tool, but if you're not using Symfony 2, you can write your own modules, your own collectors, and collect data in there as well. For example, what we did, this is now screenshots of the profile toolbar on ResearchGate, so you see it looks already kind of different. We measure different things than Symfony in the timeline there. We also measure all the requests to our cache, to the all HTTP requests we are doing for our application to other services, or MongoDB and Postgres queries. We measure all exceptions and lock them in there. We log what our dependency injection container is doing, and we also have a structure where we have very many components on one page, and we measure how long each of these components took and how long each of these calls took. So we really have a fine-grained view on what's happening. And what you then also can do, same as the XHProf, you can say, okay, for 1% of my production service, for 1% of my requests, I'm actually collecting all this data, also for normal users. Of course, I should not show them this toolbar, that would be kind of bad, but I still can collect the data, write it somewhere, and then aggregate it and see, have a look at it if something was wrong. And this helped us at least a lot with finding bugs. And for aggregation, we wrote like a very small Angular application, for example, that aggregates graphs from Graphi. This is, for example, a job detail page, which takes like in means 367 milliseconds, all the logs from our central log management with all the exceptions that happened on this page and how long all of these components on this page took. For example, here's one that took like 148 milliseconds and how each of these database calls and were in there also took to have like a very, on average, these are all averages for these pages, to have a very detailed look on our platform. And then you can dive down and find out more and look into XHProf and what really happened there. So, I talked a lot about quality, how this is important for continuous deployment, about development process, how this is important for continuous deployment, about how to find out bugs, how to monitor everything that you really know what's happening, and how to get all your build process automated and deployment process automated. The synopsis of that, what you should take out of it in the end, is just you should always think about your process, invest in your process to make it as good for you as possible. You should also think about quality all the time, make the quality of your application and the quality assurance of your application more efficient and better, because less bugs and better quality pays off. You should think about performance, because performance, if your site is very slow, your users won't use it. So there are studies again for that. It's really important to have a fast site. And because we're doing web development, we don't have these like 2 years release cycles where we ship out DVDs, invest in an agile process so that you are able to maybe continuously deploy stuff to your production environments. And if not, at least do the other stuff at some points, because it's really worth it. Thank you very much. So we have like 10 minutes left for questions. So if you have one, 5 minutes. We have 5 minutes left for questions. So if you want, go ahead. In the back. The question was, how do we integrate peer review? Very good questions. I didn't talk about that. What we are doing at the moment, we are making it on demand. So if I wrote code, which I think needs to be peer reviewed, I'm sending a review request to someone. We're using a review board for that. One of the reasons behind that is that we are still using Subversion for our PHP application. We are switching over to Git in, I think, like next month or so. There's a project for that. And then we are probably doing something pull request based. I'm not quite sure yet. But it also depends on your team and how you work. You can also do just peer reviews. We often do this directly at the desk and saying, okay, we're sitting next to each other, walking through the code, both. Yes, there's also one in the back. The question was how this, when we move over to Git, how we plan to integrate pull requests into doing continuous deployment. I'm not sure yet. This is like, I have to figure out that in the next like 2-3 weeks. If you have, if you have ideas about that, we can, of course, can discuss it later on here. Any further questions? Yes.
What if you refactor a big file? Do you have to keep both versions before and after refactoring?
Okay, the question was, what about if we have a big refactoring? Do we do this with, how do we do this with feature toggles? Do we have both versions or not? It depends. It depends on the refactoring. Sometimes it's really not doable to have feature toggles in there, and then we say, okay, we are just refactoring this in very small steps. And when we are very sure when all the tests runs and everything, then it's fine. There are some things like once or twice a year we are saying, okay, this is kind of risky, but we're doing it anyways. And there are also things where we say, okay, we really copy the 2-3 files over, have 2 versions of that, and maybe 2 different class names, or even like once we hacked our class loader. and hacked it in there just because it was the easiest thing to do. So do whatever works for you in the end. It depends on your problem. Yes? Okay. Yeah. So the question was how do we handle feature flags and data schema changes? We tend to not do database schema changes if we can't help it, and if we need them, do them in a way that they work with both code versions. And maybe then do additional work to have, like, in the end, a script that syncs data over. So if you have a feature toggle that does not write into a certain column and new code behind a toggle that writes to a certain column, and we are sure we need this additional column in the end, we just then write a script to migrate the data over from the other version or something. No. We do database changes if we need them beforehand already. So in a way that database change works with the old and the new code. And we try to not do this as much as possible. Okay. The question was because we are developing in features most of the time, in bigger features, and we want to just push them up, or with a feature flag, put it online at once. Why then actually doing this whole continuous deployment thing in the end? Because the code does not get to use all the time anyways. There are two parts of the answer. First thing is that still the code is in one branch in the end, or is there, so all the tests can run against it. It gets integrated all the time, and don't have this merge hell in the end of iteration where everyone merges the features in, and then nothing does work because there are things counteracting against each other. The second thing is, you said already, bug fixes, which is very nice because they get out all the time. And also, I can iterate a lot, or if I start A-B testing, for example. If I start testing if something works, I can very quickly change things to test if I change it to certain thing, if it works better and better. So especially if you're in a phase of improving your product a lot and not cranking out lots of new features all the time, this also benefits a lot. Did this answer? Okay. I think we have to sort of, we can the continued discussion outside. Okay. Thank you very much.